This is Overdrive, Hour 2. My name is Brennan Dunlop. Happy to be alongside Dave Festchuk from the Toronto Star and former Toronto Maple Leaf Peter Holland. It's a good first hour for, I've only listened to you before. I've watched you play, obviously. I've had a couple of conversations with you here at the office, but I thought that was a pretty good first hour.
Well, I appreciate the feedback. I like to joke that every show is a tryout, you know? So every hour is a tryout, every block's a tryout, and I just keep coming back.
It's, trust me, it feels like that for me, my friend. I guess that's how we connect. Yeah. This is an interesting time of year, though, Dave, as you know, someone who's constantly busy. I know you're on the Leafs beat and the Raptors beat, but you always seem to like fill the time. It's 24-7. Yeah. Do you enjoy these moments where you've got a little bit of a break and you can do a bit more just storytelling and banter and just kind of shoot it with the boys?
Yeah, no, hey, I love the summer.
Breaking routine.
No, it's great. It's a great time of year. I love the All-Star game, man. It's always been one of my favorites. So I'm looking forward to tonight. I enjoyed the Home Run Derby last night. And I like the ESPYs too. I don't know, like that Wednesday after the All-Star game, like the notoriously slowest day in sports, to me, like, I think it's always a good show.
They've made it their own, right? They own that day and recognize at a time when, you know, I think that's kind of something where you wouldn't be surprised if in the pandemic or now, it's all of a sudden, let's own the day after. Like, at that moment, it was pretty, you know, forward-thinking. And they've built it into something pretty special. I enjoy watching that ESPYs every Wednesday after the All-Star game too.
I can't comment. I'm not a big ESPYs guy.
Okay.
Not a big awards show guy in general?
Down on the awards show.
No, unless Ricky Gervais is hosting.
Wasn't that a classic?
Oh, it's amazing. The amount of times I've gone back and just rewatched his clips from that, it's too much.
But he's too mean for today's athletes. Like, yeah. I won't have him back.
Yeah. What year was that?
I can't even remember, but it was classic.
Yeah.
You remember the year? It was
I don't remember the year, but it was like, come up, accept your little award, get off the stage.
I think
those award shows in general, like the NHL has grown to have a lot of fun with the NHL award show.
They're trying to do it so they get more viewers, but for some reason, I feel like it's sort of not clicking yet.
Mm.
Like, I don't know. I don't know what it is. Maybe a time of year. I don't know. I feel like it could be better. Not that I have an answer to how it could be or why it's not. It's just, I feel like it just hasn't clicked as like a great time for fans to, you know, jump around the All-Star game and get excited about it.
Award shows are tricky. And I think in sports, it's one thing that they want to get right. When it comes to All-Star games, sometimes they do get it right. We talk about how baseball hasn't had to really change the model, but hockey is constantly changing to try and get it right or really hit. With award shows, it's almost like expected that these leagues better be doing something like this. But it's not as easy to pull off. Soccer's got two, and they struggle with that too. Mm-hmm. They try and make it a spectacle, try and make it like the Oscars, and then it can feel cheesy and cheap.
Yeah.
But I think the NHL has got to a point now where they found the good balance, where making it a show, but not as cheesy and cheap.
Well, McDavid and Stamkos win 50% of the awards. Just invite those two guys every year and you're done.
Yeah, they could get a much smaller arena. They could get a much smaller space, right? They could be doing it wherever Wayne Newton's doing his shows now. Have you seen Wayne Newton in Vegas? That was something I did recently.
You saw Wayne Newton in Vegas?
I did. It was kind of
you're into the classics.
Man, it was kind of a bit. It was kind of a joke. I heard Wayne Newton on another talk sports show, and he was quite the character. And even the hosts were like, why did the producers book this guy? Man, he's Mr. Vegas. Like, we're talking about whatever it was Vegas related. The producer thought he was being advantageous to go out and get Wayne Newton. And the hosts had the best time with him. He was telling old stories. He was talking about, you know, what it was like in the 60s and old Vegas, new Vegas. And it was just incredible. And not at all the personality that you expected. So I always
that
had this obsession.
Like a lot of fun.
Okay. I go back to Vegas. I got to see him. Like, I didn't, you know, I was too young to see Sinatra. I regret not seeing Tony Bennett.
Okay.
He's not technically in that class, but he's sort of in that age bracket, right? Of classic legend.
Here's an off-the-cuff one for you.
Here we go.
I would like to see Celine Dion.
Okay.
I think she would be incredible to see live.
Mrs. Vegas for a minute, she would have been.
Yeah. She still has a...
still performing.
Yeah, she's still performing there, I think. She's still got a residency, doesn't she?
Yeah, it might be like a part-time or it's dwindled a little bit.
She's not been well lately, I think. There's been some illness of some sort. Okay. I'm not like up to speed on it, but I did see something about she's not been playing.
But that would be someone that I would love to see perform. Like, I know Elton John just stopped touring. I think last weekend was his last show, Friday or Saturday night in Stockholm. That was the it for
or
him.
So he says.
Or so he says. But I mean, that would be another guy. I'd be like, yes, I'm going to this concert.
I still vividly remember you know, the big hype around. I'm old enough to remember the Who's last show, which was in Toronto in 1980 something, and it was like it was on TV, live TV, and I was always a big Who fan, and of course they're still playing 40 years later.
Yeah.
So when Elton runs out of money, maybe there'll be another tour.
You know,
because these tours are like retirement savings for a lot of these, you know,
did you
older
see,
artists.
I was just reading on the this morning. I think Taylor Swift is having one of the highest grossing tours of all time. I think she's going to gross over $1 billion. She's making something like $13 million a night.
Wow.
Just incredible.
Like something like the Leafs make on beer.
Yeah.
At 25 bucks a pop.
Right, exactly.
That would be. I know I did the World Cup in Qatar where, you know, the prices were a premium for beer. And everyone that went there knew that going in. But now that's just normal prices at sporting events here.
None of the Canadians flinched. They're like, yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, $22 for a bottle of what we would call domestic beer over there.
Wow. And they wouldn't even serve it at the stadiums, right?
They didn't serve it at the stadium.
They pulled the rug out from under the beer drinkers on the 11th hour.
But it's a common thing in soccer.
They didn't want anybody to not show up.
Yeah,
they wanted
exactly.
to get everybody here.
Oh, there's
going to
be beer.
Them.
Not, right? Yeah. Like, that was a dirty trick they played.
Yeah.
Well, keep the hockey talk going. We got into some good bits in the first hour of the show, and very happy to bring on former NHL head coach and NHL Network analyst Bruce Boudreau on Overdrive. Bruce, how are you?
I'm doing well, man. How are you?
Doing good. We're getting into everything. It is MLB All-Star Game Tuesday. It's the start of the summer for a lot of hockey people who, after that free agency deadline, can kind of unplug for a little bit. So we appreciate you not unplugging your phone and still being up for some hockey talk. But how do you start July?
Well, I mean, probably the same way I started June, doing nothing.
Fair answer.
Yeah, fair answer.
You know, you just try to get it, you know, when you've been involved in hockey all your life, you just, you know, you read as much as you can, find out as much as you can, and you try to stay relevant and involved. That's pretty well what you do. So, I mean, you know, we've just had a free agency, and that's, and now the development camps are pretty well all done. So I think the GMs and everybody want to get out of Dodge. And if they've got one last player to get until the middle of August, then they'll start getting tryout guys to come to camp and go from there. And then it starts all over again.
You're a full-time analyst now. Like you, the preparation in the summer is obviously
that's
different.
That's only if I don't get another job.
I'm
in it for now.
I'm sure there's a mix of phone calls that you're having. But as Peter can attest to now, being the prepping for the show and being on this side of the microphone, you definitely put a lot of work in. But it would allow you to have a bit more freedom at the best time of the year in Canada to be outside anyway than you would have in a regular coaching cycle.
For sure. Bruce, I'm curious. You mentioned development camp, which we know closely follows the draft. I need a coach's take on this. Like or dislike the development camp? Does it mess up your summer going in there for a week and going in with the young guys?
Well, for the head coach, there's really not much to do. So, I mean, actually, we're not even allowed to be part of it, quite frankly. But it doesn't really mess up the summer. If you go home after the season, it's always great to come back to the town that you're coaching in, whether it was Anaheim, Minnesota, Washington, or Vancouver. I mean, for a week's time, you get to meet with your coaches. I mean, I think it's a good time to meet when you're a coach, to meet with the coaches just to set the plan in motion before everybody sort of takes off for the summer. So I think it's good. Like, I mean, the development camp, Peter, you were in it I'm sure a few times. It's a
couple times I was there.
It's changed a lot since even in the last 10 years. So it's not like you have to worry about, oh, I better be in great shape when I go there, because I mean half the time you don't even go on the ice anymore. They just want to introduce you to what professional hockey might all be like when you get there.
I certainly came up in the wrong era then, because we were joking at the gym the other day that guys got to show up in shape to start their summer training these days. Guys are just nuts. They're always on top of it. But
were you you go to the one in Anaheim that I ran?
Well, yeah, that's why I was curious, because when you said that the head coaches couldn't be involved, I was like, I don't remember that being my experience. I remember the head coach being around.
I know. Well, that's now. I mean, I know Bob Murray, and as we all do, very fondly, right?
Yeah.
That he told me to run a training camp basically like they would find an NHL training camp. So, I mean, that's with the conditioning and everything else in it. Now it's more of a, hey, this is what social media is like. This is what nutrition is like. This is, you know, let's go to a ball game. This is, you want to get to the NHL. This is what it's going to be like when you get there type thing.
Well, I certainly remember the conditioning. There may have been a baseball game in there. I remember going to an Angels game, but I remember by the time that baseball game came around, all I wanted to do was go kick my feet up in the hotel because I was exhausted from the day's activities. It was a long day, those development camps.
Yes, they were. Yes, they were. I mean, and they were longer before that. In the early 2000s or 1990s, Andy Murray had a two-week development camp. And he ran it just like an NHL training camp. And there was more injuries than you can shake a stick at. But thank God they've come to a little more of their senses these days.
So, Bruce, speaking of training camps, the Leafs are going to, you know, start one in September. And the guy presiding over it is a surprise to me because we've seen, you know, the turmoil in Leafland with Kyle Dubas leaving for Pittsburgh. And after he was fired by Brendan Shanahan in a moment of huge drama, in the front office in Toronto. And, of course, he's been attached at the hip to Sheldon Keefe. Dubas has. And yet, with Brad Treliving coming in as GM, Sheldon Keefe is still the head coach of the Toronto Maple Leafs. You've been in all kinds of situations in your career. How would you sort of assess this situation that Keefe finds himself in with a general manager that is not his guy?
Well, I mean, maybe they really like each other once they've talked. I mean, I don't... Who knows how the relationship has gotten from when Brad got the job? But I mean, let's face it: the Leafs' regular season has been great. It's the playoffs that have not been as successful. So I mean, I firmly believe that he's going to have a great regular season again. But sometimes, if you don't get the ultimate success, you get fired. Look at, we won four division championships in Anaheim. And we went to the conference finals, and we lost in seven games to the cup winners, and I still got fired because we didn't win the cup. So, I mean, it was the same GM. So, I mean, it's either you have patience and you think that you're going to get there, or you just sort of change the roles. I think Sheldon's done a really good job, but, I mean, I guess, next year will be the year that, you know, I think he's got to get further than what he's gotten this year, or I think it'll be time for a change.
And your resume is at the top of Brad Treliving's desk or what?
Well, I am a Toronto boy.
Well, we know you're a big fan of the Buds. So as all of our GTA fellow folk here are.
The appearances on this show would be a little different, though, with Bruce. I kind of like how laid back. It sounds like you've got to speed up now.
Yeah, we might see a different side of Bruce, one that I may have seen in the past, but maybe not one.
Bruce, I'm curious. We just had this conversation where Peter mentioned, I asked, you know, the distractions in the locker room. Does it exist? If you've got, you know, two big names in contract negotiations, as the Leafs obviously have right now, and the season starts, now how much of it is a distraction in the room? And Peter said, look, as a player, I'm focused on my game, you know, my own contract. But as a coach, do you feel that distraction? Is it tangible in the room?
Well, I don't think it's a distraction now, right yet. I mean, they're under contract for another year. So, I mean, I don't think it's that big of a deal, quite frankly. The only time it becomes when you start going to camp, when the coaches get together at the beginning of September, and then they start putting, you know, their lineups together. You'd like to know what your lineup is. You wouldn't like to have the flux of maybe, okay, is he going to get traded? Is he not? Are the rumors still going? Or are we waiting till, you know, till trade deadline this year or something? But at the beginning of the year, I don't think it's, you know, like Peter said, even if a player or a coach, you focus on your own job. And like I've always said, whoever's there will coach. Whoever's not there, we won't coach. And I mean, I'm sure behind closed doors, you really want them to be there. But I mean, it's and you got to go with the assumption that they're going to be there. But I mean, you adjust if they're not. And I'm sure if they neither one of those guys that we're talking about are there, then I mean, you're getting some pretty darn good players in return too. So I mean, it's I don't think the Leafs are kind of team that are going for draft picks at this stage of their of the season or the where they're at as a team.
Well, that's an interesting point you make, Bruce, because the you know Matthews, I think a lot of people assume it's a non-negotiable. They got to re-sign him at some number. That's and we all assume that there will be a number that makes sense. Might be a little higher than a lot of fans would like, but it'll get done. Nylander's the trickier one in a lot of ways because you know he's obviously been a great performer, you know, for the contract and just you know in general he's been one of the elite forwards in the league. And yet, you know, clearly he's slow playing this and wants a you know what he feels he's worth. And yet, you see a guy like Alex DeBrincat signed with Detroit for 4 years at 7.8, and DeBrincat's actually scored more goals than Nylander has. What do you make of that? And what do you think Nylander could fetch if indeed it came to the you know the pointy business of saying, look, we can't give you what you want. We're going to have to move you.
Well, I mean, first of all, I mean, I coached his dad, Michael, and he was a tough sign for Washington. I mean, you know, he was stubborn and he held his ground and he to get what he wanted. And if you look at what Nylander did the last time he had a contract, he held out till December 1st and until he got what he wanted. So I don't think he's ready to take a hometown discount. I think he's going to want what he thinks his value is, and he's just come off his best year as a Leaf. So I mean, I think he wants that. He would love to be in Toronto, but I think he's not going to go for any less than $9 million. And I think if he does it, I think being this year of when he's going to want an 8-year deal. That's just what I think. Anyway, I don't think he's going to go for 2 years. I mean, he looks at Tavares getting older and that other, you know, the core four maybe not being there when it's all said and done. So I think he wants to get as much money as he can right now.
We're talking with former NHL head coach and NHL Network analyst Bruce Boudreau here on Overdrive. Bruce, there's still a couple of interesting names on the market. Patrick Kane, Vladimir Tarasenko. How much do you think these guys got left in the tank?
Well, I mean, I don't think you have to make a decision about Patrick Kane. He's not going to be ready till Christmas with the hip surgeries. And, I mean, he's earned the right to wait as long as he wants. And if he wants to play, I don't think it's going to be about money. It's going to be about getting a chance to win again and play where he wants to. But Tarasenko, I think, is taken aback a little bit that he thought the market would have been more for him. Mm-hmm. And it just wasn't there. And it's like sometimes when you're talked about as how great he was for, I think, 8 or 10 years, then all of a sudden he doesn't have that great year and he's not talked about in the same vein, then all of a sudden you still want to get paid the way you feel you've been talked about, but you're just not the same player that you were, and it's hard for players to accept that. So, but, I mean, the talk was, if they can come up with a number, probably Ottawa seemed like a good landing spot for him after they lost to Brinkett. But who knows? I mean, there's a lot of guys still out there. I mean, what's Matt Dumba doing? I think he's a pretty good defenseman. So, I mean, we're looking at him. But sometimes you look at Klingberg last year, they expect too much and all of a sudden they get left in the dust. And especially now, you know, with the cap going to go up probably in the next 2 years, GMs are really sort of being a little bit smart about this and not paying the way they were paying a couple of years ago.
What's your take on the Erik Karlsson situation in San Jose? It seems like both sides are in agreement. You know, he's expressed interest for a trade. San Jose seems like they're on board to do so. you know, is there enough interest out there, you think, for it to happen, or do you think he starts the season in a Sharks uniform?
Well, I certainly believe that there's a lot of teams that would like to have him on their blue line. The question is, again, how much? What's he got, 4 years left, I think? And how much San Jose was gonna take? I mean, everybody, you know, you've listened to everybody, and the more they take, the more San Jose will get. But the less they take, the less teams want to give them, type thing. So, I mean, who wouldn't want them? I think there's, you know, when you get a 100-point defenseman, I mean, even if it's for 2 more years out of the 4 that he can go at that rate, I mean, you'd like to get him. And every now and again, a new rumor from a new team comes out. But San Jose obviously would love to start over without him. So I think where there's a will to make the deal, they'll eventually make the deal. But I don't think they're going to give him away for a 4th-round pick or anything.
Well, you don't come across a 100-point defenseman every day, so no. I believe that there's certainly going to be interest, as you said. And Bruce, before we let you go, I gotta tap into the memory archives a little bit with you.
Yes.
Do you remember when we were at the Anaheim Ducks season ticket holder event and Bobby Ryan handed me the mic to go up on stage and jabber away for as long as I could in a very awkward situation? Do you recall this?
Your first year?
This was the first time I had an extended stay with the team, and it got to the point where I ran out of things to say, and so the audience started throwing questions at me, and one of them came from the back of the room, and someone yelled out, "Are you single?" And I said, "Yes, I'm very single." And then from the front row, you said, "I hope you like to travel." And Bruce, I gotta tell you, you were right.
Well, I just knew at the time, and taking nothing away from you, Peter, you're, you know, first round pick and so much talent. But when you were going up and back, I mean, that was my life, and I knew that if you were gonna get involved with a woman, as long as your career was going to go, there's a lot of traveling in hockey from everybody. So, I mean, you have to have a special woman to be a hockey player's wife.
Oh, sure. Do you ever? And boy, do I wish I was picking up the air miles back then. I'd still be flying for free.
there's a TV show to be had there. There was a TV show for a time, the Hockey Wives, right? There's definitely a few seasons you can get through in that.
That's right.
Well, Bruce, I don't know if you're a baseball fan, if you're going to enjoy watching the All-Star game tonight, but I very much enjoyed this conversation with you. All the best with the summer. Enjoy the summer, and I have a feeling we'll be talking to you again soon.
Yeah, and I will be watching the game, as I'm a sports fan of pretty well everything. So enjoy the night. It's a beautiful July night to watch a baseball game. As long as it doesn't go on for 4 hours, we'll be watching.
it's the spectacle. That's the showcase. They'll drag it out as long as the whoever the broadcaster is in the States will allow it to go. But Bruce, we appreciate it.
All right. Well, you guys have a great day then.
We'll talk to you again.
Thanks, Bruce.
Bruce Boudreau, former NHL head coach, former head coach of you, Peter Holland.
Good guy. Like, that's a coach where you're just like, this is a good guy. And, you know, like, he'd take you out of the lineup, but it was just like, it was never personal. You know, it was just like, it was just part of the job.
Yeah.
He was just a guy you could go into his office and just, the door was always open. You could chat with him, and he was great.
From our side of things, he's always struck me as that type of guy.
Yeah.
That everyone has something very good to say about him. Seems very personal. Doesn't take himself or the job too seriously. It does seem like that is fleeting, though, in all aspects of the sport, right? And there's so much pressure. You hear the way he talks about having been good to, you know, get the Ducks to the conference final as many times as they did.
Well, the job, as we know, is it's very much, what have you done for me lately?
Mm-hmm.
So you can have as much regular season success as you want, but when it comes down to crunch time, every team's vying for the Stanley Cup. That's what they're there to do and there to win. And if you're not getting the job done, then changes have to be made, as hard as they may be.
Hmm. I wonder why that doesn't apply in Toronto.
It doesn't apply in Toronto. But was it you that joked about him being here? What it would
I have a feeling his resume has probably been sent to Brad Tree Living a few times.
Agents might be making the phone call. Yeah. I mean, yeah, you've always got to be looking out. There's,
he gave a very politically correct answer about wishing Sheldon Keefe well, and he's done a tremendous job. But we all know Bruce is a big Leaf fan, and I would imagine he'd love to coach the Buds.
How long before you think we see him in a job? Do you think he's going to...
I think soon. I think he's a great coach. He's a good person, as we just talked about. So I think there's a lot of demand for a guy like that. So I wouldn't be surprised if he got scooped up relatively quickly anyway.
Well, he was very quick to dissuade when I called him. I labeled him a full-time analyst.
Yeah, for now.
Yeah, for
hang
now.
On.
For now, soccer guy. I'm just a full-time analyst for now.
Good for Bruce. He had to push back on that.
That's right.
Oh, good conversation with Bruce Boudreau. We'll get to plenty more hockey talk, but time to take a break. You are watching Overdrive on TSN4, listening on TSN Radio 1050 and the iHeartRadio app. Back on Overdrive, yes, but without Hayes Noodles and the O-Dog. My name is Brendan Dunlop. Happy to be alongside Dave Festchuk and former Toronto Maple Leaf Peter Holland, former Anaheim Duck. Peter Holland as well. It was nice to chat with
former coach.
Your old coach, Bruce Boudreau, on the Maple Toyota Hotline in our last segment. We were going to speak with Jackie Redman in this show, but stuck in travel. As fun as that can be, traveling in the summer, for anyone who has flown in North America since the COVID-19 pandemic, everyone has some nightmare travel story. And Jackie was supposed to have flown at lunchtime, and now is... flying drive time. So we'll speak to her tomorrow on Overdrive.
Can't wait.
Do you have a lot of travel, any travel nightmares since the pandemic? Have you traveled a lot less? I mean, you went to Tokyo. You did the Olympics.
Tokyo, that actually went pretty well. Yeah, the Tokyo flight went well. Went to Beijing for the other Olympics, which
was
way too close together.
Yes.
That was a travel nightmare because we flew, I believe, from Toronto to Turkey and then from Turkey to one of the other airports in China, and then from that airport to Beijing.
Why did you go that way?
Somebody pointed out, you're going the wrong way.
Yeah.
If you're going to Turkey.
Did you fly into Istanbul?
We did.
How long was your layover?
Very long.
Did you go into the Turkish Airlines lounge?
Went into many lounges and had many naps.
The Turkish Airline lounge in Istanbul is incredible.
Really?
They have a golf simulator in there.
Oh.
They have nap pods, they have showers, they have cuisine from all over the world, like hot tables of Italian, American, Turkish, coffee, whatever, you name it, they have it. It is remarkable. My first year on the way to Russia, that's how I went. I flew through Istanbul.
Right.
And so I had a 9-hour layover, and it flew by in this lounge. It was incredible.
I think ours was like 15 or something, something crazy. Something crazy. Crazy layover. But the funny thing about flying through Istanbul, the guys on OD, the A team on Overdrive, always talk about the full salad reboot in Turkey. Mm. You know, the hair replacement.
Yeah, it's a popular industry.
It is no joke.
Yeah.
Like, I got on the return flight flew from Beijing back to Istanbul, back to Toronto, and the return flight from Istanbul to Toronto, it wasn't Turkish Airlines, it was Turkish Hairlines. Okay? I'm not kidding you. I'm not 5%. I'm going to say 5 to 10% of the flight were guys that had got their hair transplanted. And they all had these black headbands and they all had like gauze on their scalps. Freshly done. You could sort of make out the little rows of new holes that had been poked in their head where the sprouts were going to come from of the new salad. And it was just, it was amazing because I didn't realize. I'd always heard Noodles talk about it, but I didn't know that it was as big as it is. And guess what? It's big.
We are three well-follicled men on this show.
That's what.
And I don't think that Noodles is... Noodles doesn't...
No, but he always... he just always brings it up because he's got, I guess, contemporaries who've been tempted to head over to Istanbul.
Sure. It's definitely the thing. Like, it's if your friend tells you they're going to Turkey and they are a little less follicled, and you just kind of assume that that's why they're going. Right? Yeah. I've got friends. I'm like, you have never expressed any interest in travel. Like traveling to Tennessee seems too far. You're going to go to Turkey, and there's Now I got it, Mike. No, have a great time in Turkey.
I just hadn't experienced it firsthand. It is quite the sight. Turkish Hairlines.
Make some time for something else. I think producer the Grappler, it's time to make some time for Confirm or Deny. Brought to you. I've gone ahead. I've gone too early on that. We've bumped things. This is what happens when you get to, when you get the rental host to fly in here.
This is also what happens when now old school producer that I've apparently become prefers to print off lineups as opposed to using the live lineup that you are so accustomed to.
Yeah, that's it, my friend. I guess we're just going to have to change.
We're just going to have to talk about more travel horror stories, right, which is fine because I got one.
Oh, tell me, Russia. Here we go.
Well, it's funny. It actually wasn't Russia. Russia was certainly interesting. You pull into some airports in Russia and they don't even look like an airport. They look like one of those like construction trailers. And your plane pulls up, and there's like literally a dump truck that pulls up to the side of the plane, and they just start tossing bags into there. And you're like kind of laughing. Anyway, that's not the story I'm going with. But on my way home from Sweden, I had my 3-month-old daughter, and this was travel from hell. Like, it was unbelievable how many things went wrong. We had to connect through Heathrow, and we had to walk basically, you know, one of those underground walkways that you go to the far side of the airport. You got to go underneath the tarmac to the other terminal. So on the way down, the escalator stopped working. So I got a stroller and 3 carry-on luggage bags halfway down this escalator that just stops dead.
Oh, no.
Now I got to carry everything back up, carry my daughter down, get on the one that's right. It was so then plane's delayed, get to Toronto. We've had this crazy long 14, 15-hour travel day. We're going through security. My wife and I have Nexus. So we're like, finally, we're home. We're going to be done with this. We're in the Nexus line. But the monitors kiosks weren't working, which was par for the course for this day. So we had to go up to the border security, and we get up there. Booth. And the lovely lady who was working the booth says, "Your daughter doesn't have Nexus. You can't be in this line." And I'm looking at this immigration line that's 3 hours long, and we're at the front of this Nexus line. And I'm a little bit flustered because of the entire day we've been having traveling with my infant. And I'm like, but she's 3 months old. Like, my wife and I, we have Nexus. And I'm sort of playing with my mask at the time because I'm just so flustered but trying to stay calm. And she gets mad at me for adjusting my mask. She's like, it's very unsafe. She was sitting behind what I only assume was bulletproof glass. And I was so upset because I'm finally home. I'm like, okay, we've come this far. My career's what I thought over. I'm like, we're just, you know, finally we're back in Canada. This feels good, you know? And then all of a sudden I'm like, oh, I was angry for 3 hours.
That's the welcome.
Did
you say, but I played for the league?
No, yeah. I was so distraught.
That sucks.
It's you do not strike me as a guy that has ever used that card. Like, I would use that card all the time. Are you kidding me? I would pump in gas. I would use that to try and get in the on ramp, you know, the person that drives in the left lane and then tries to cut over. I would just be like, it would be the sticker on the back of my car. I played for the Leafs.
I didn't like to pull it, but there was certain times when you had to, when you're out at the bar with buddies during the summer and there's a massive lineup because you got there a little bit late and then you got to go up and grease the wheels of the bouncer a little bit. So it was like every training camp or I guess it wasn't training camp, be a few months into the season when you got your NHLPA card with your little picture on it, says you're part of the NHL and the team you play with. You just keep that in the wallet for a rainy day.
Oh, there you go. That's a good card to have.
Did it ever work to your advantage playing in another city or in another market where you see someone standing in line that you recognize and someone, you know, working the bouncer or someone working the door spots you and then you go in first?
I don't know that I ever tried it in another market, to tell you the truth. Huh. I think I only ever really tried it in Toronto when I was still in my my single days running around the downtown core.
In the 20s, yeah?
In the 20s.
There was a few TFC guys that used to frequent King West, as most people do. In their mid-20s or late-20s.
King West, where's that?
Well, there was one guy, very very prominent player on the team, who I seem to always run into if I wasn't going out very often. In Montreal, in Toronto, there was somewhere in the States. That TFC guy was always out. And he's standing he's at the very front of the line. There was really nobody kind of there. And the bouncer spots me from the old TV show, the soccer TV show I used to do. And does not see this very prominent player like literally in front of me and goes, "Hey man, don't stand in line, come in here." And the player says, like, "Are you bleeping serious? Like, this is your friend, obviously."
That's great.
How did that happen? And it was about 10 minutes later in the bar before I saw this player. Did he make you wait the whole time? And he just nodded like, "Yeah, have a good night, bro."
That is okay. Awesome.
So yeah, it pays to be very
well. Be a TV personality.
Yeah, I guess so. Not with the eye like I've got today, my friend. I just battling through. I wish I had a horror story to tell you, or not a horror story, a brave story, like something from men's league hockey. But my team played at 11 o'clock. Right?
Do you bail on those games?
No, I
be
never,
honest.
I never bail on those games.
Interesting.
But my body told me to bail last night. And so I did.
You listen to your body. But what a pro you are.
I usually don't, though.
What a pro
it's
you
a
are,
new
right?
thing. You know, it's about it's about trying to be the balanced, you know, new dad, trying to be the balanced TV radio guy. I usually don't. It was, I guess I've tried a new thing, right? At all stages in life, you're like, I'm going to try this diet or I'm going to sleep more. I guess that was it for me. Finally listen to my body.
What's the latest? Because I don't play men's
11.
Oh, that's the latest.
11 p.m.
Okay, because I thought there was some leagues that they would literally play at midnight.
There might be some midnights. I haven't played them.
Like, I feel like you just have to draw the line.
Yeah.
Like, you're getting up for work the next day.
Most people are.
Most people are. Yeah.
Right? Like, you're getting up at 6, 7 o'clock to get to work.
Yeah, I know. I don't understand. And you always see, you know, the bench is always shorter at 11.
Oh, well, I would think.
The boys went 6-4 last night. I'm like, I'm not showing up to be the 7th forward.
Yeah, that's not actually worse.
Not a chance. Way worse. To cycle through the lines like that? No, the worst. Do you play a lot of pickup in the offseason? Do you play?
No, I never really did play a ton of pickup. I was always just doing like more skill work and stuff like that. But it's interesting now because a lot of the guys I'm in touch with, they're actually playing pickup.
Okay.
And so I don't know if like something's changed or maybe I was just out of the loop when I was younger and guys were always doing it. But yeah, guys are playing pickup now, which I find odd, to be quite honest, because I got some friends that play. And I'm not saying that the guys I'm referencing that play professional hockey are playing in the same pickup leagues as my buddies. But when I hear some of the stories out of these pickup hockey leagues, I'm like, I want nothing.
Nothing to do with that. Yeah. There would be a bit of a target on your back, right? I did play with a bunch of guys that would love the chance to share the ice with some of the people that I've been fortunate enough to work with on air. Oh, why didn't you bring that guy out?
Yeah.
I wouldn't want to be in that situation.
No, the worst thing about men's league sports is the fights in men's league.
Well, that's what I'm talking about.
Like,
and just like the stick work.
Yeah.
Oh, the stick work.
Like, you just can't get, and you know, no offense to everyone out there who's a heck of a men's league hockey player, because everyone thinks they're a heck of a hockey player.
There's some all-stars out there.
There's some all-stars out there.
Legends.
White gloves, tinted visor.
Just no control of your stick. Mm. And so for a guy who's wearing a visor out there, like I fear for my life. I just can't do it.
You're a TV guy now. You want to play pickup, you got to go full fishbowl.
You have to.
That's my TV professional advice to you, my man.
You go full. Do you go fishbowl or do you go cage?
I got the hybrid fishbowl. It's the
visor. The Mighty Duck thing?
No. I mean, it's the visor, but it's connected to the cage bottom.
Yeah, that's what the Mighty Ducks all wore. The movie.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I didn't realize it was the cage bottom, though. No, I think I feel special. It's the one, the full plastic.
I think Fulton Reed. Yeah, you're like Fulton Reed out there with the half five. Visor half cage.
It does make me feel. In the pandemic, when I had the longer hair hanging out the back of the helmet too, it made me feel faster.
Oh, you are one of those all-stars.
One of those guys.
No, you keep stats?
Not white.
You come back to the bench, you go, guys, plus two.
No, I mean, I'm aware that in summer league, I've scored 5 goals and in the regular season. But I mean, just ask the goal fathers.
I'm going to be leading the league, but nobody's going to look it up.
Yeah, one day I'll get my picture on the wall at the rink there at Markham and Steeles, but today is not that day, Peter Holland.
Okay.
Today is not that day. I wanted to get into some of your locker room talk and about what's happening with the Toronto Maple Leafs and more on Overdrive. This is on TSN 4 and TSN 1050 in the iHeartRadio app. This is Overdrive, brought to you by FanDuel, bringing you everything from the opening line to the final score. I am not Brian Hayes. He is on vacation, probably golfing. Dave Feshuk is not O-Dog. Was definitely have golf today, but not at this point of the day.
I was going to say, he's definitely a morning guy.
100% a morning guy.
He responded to a text from me, O-Dog I'm talking about, at 4:15 in the morning. And I was like, oh, everything okay? He's like, yeah, man, it's just what time I get up. So definitely a morning guy.
You thought you were the first guy in the gym with Gary Roberts?
Yeah.
Nope. O-Dog's.
O-Dog's. O-Dog was in and out I was there.
Getting the oats. Have you played a lot of golf, Peter Holland, with O-Dog?
I have played one round with O. This was going back quite a few years now. This was back when I was with the Leafs, I think. One of the former owners of the Guelph Storm, where I played junior hockey, as did O, invited us out, and we played around. And I think it was the easiest 72 I've ever seen. O just dialed.
Wow.
Yeah, he can play. He's good. He's really good. Like, just easy, you know? Like, doesn't look hard, hits it down the middle, goes up there, hits it again onto the green, makes his two-putt, drops a couple birdies. Like, it was just the easiest round of no sweat golf I've seen.
Wow.
Yeah. So he's a, yeah, he's a player.
I'm not particularly surprised by that. Like, he just seems like someone that just doesn't take it too seriously. Everything's like, everything's easy and smooth. It's the same as he is on air.
Yeah.
Goal scorer's hands, man. Yeah.
Well, that's what it is. Like, for sure. Like, he hit a few short game chip shots around the green where I'm like, yeah, that probably explains why he scored 40 goals.
Yeah.
We were talking about our men's league exploits, or excuse me, I was, 5 goals in summer league. And the grappler, the producer, producer Keith comes in and says, well, you don't want to ask me about softball? Grappler, now that we're into golf again, you do have an opportunity, my friend. You must have played a lot with O-Dog.
No, I've played a handful of rounds with him. And what I was going to say in terms of how, like, you know, easy and smooth it is for him on the golf course.
Yeah.
There are times where he'll come in here and we're about to do a show and he'll have played golf earlier in the day and he'll just say, like, man, it was such a boring round. Like, I just went out there. I'm just going out there and shooting 68 every day.
That's what I'm talking about, man. That's what I'm talking about.
And it drives me nuts. Like, you want to call that boring? I mean, I guess if you're doing it every day, like, sure, it's boring, but what I would give to be playing boring golf and just going and shooting 68 every day. It drove me nuts hearing that from him.
Did you suggest that he, like, try and make it more difficult for himself? Like, play the whole course right, but then drive left?
Well, so he, you know, I'm not sure how much you're able to catch the show, but something that he's always on Hayes about is, like, so Hayes golfs, like, swings the club right-handed, but then he putts left-handed.
Okay.
I know just a guy putt, does though. That.
So
crazy.
So he's always on Brian, like, trying to get him to putt right-handed. So yeah, what I would love to suggest to O is, like, go and play left-handed, or yeah, drive left-handed, just something to mix it up a little bit. And it doesn't help. I mean, listen, he's a member at Westham, beautiful course, but you know, when you're playing the same course day in, day out, I'm sure it's stunning, but yeah, I think playing the same 18 holes could be, you know, it would get a little repetitive, I think.
That's how I started playing golf, and it might explain why I don't want to continue playing. But my brother-in-law took me out in Vancouver at Gino Ogic's course. And I could not, for the life of me, hit with the right-handed clubs that I had. And, I mean, in general, I guess I shouldn't have been surprised. But I said, you know, in hockey, I shoot left, and I just think I should try left. And someone happened to be behind us that was playing left. So, well, drive and see. Boom, right down the middle, 200 yards, 250. It was the first thing I'd hit well all day. So I borrowed this driver for the rest of the rounds.
And then it made it home with you.
And yeah, and played the rest of the course right, though. And yeah, that's it. So I can get that. But yeah, no, a lot of camaraderie on the golf course. You talked about the alumni tournament. Talking about the differences in the locker rooms. One of the things I found interesting is you said, you know, as an older guy now, you see the dynamic in the room is very different than when you were the young guy. There was a lot of old guys. It seems as though overall that generational gap has made a very different dynamic in the room.
Yeah, I think it's changed quite a bit. We were chatting off air that when I was coming up, it was very common to have multiple guys in their 30s. Like, it was more rare for half the team to be in their 20s. So a lot older generations, and I think that's shifted quite a bit now where we're seeing the average age of teams is like 24, 20, yeah, you know, 20.
It gets pretty low.
It gets pretty low, and it's just a different culture, I think, when that's the case, because, you know, back when I was coming up, guys were always getting together. There was, you know, team meals, going for beers after practice, whatever it may be, whereas now with the younger guys, it's like they start bringing their Xboxes on the plane, which is just like, to me, it's just strange. I don't know. And, you know, to the other point, when you get to the hotel, guys are doing like the room service and stuff. I don't know. I was just always wanted to get out there and see what was out in the city.
See the city.
Yeah.
See the city.
A bit of a throwback take, right? This playoff run with the Leafs, we were having a chat with Luke Shen at his locker. This was not long after the Leafs finally won a round. And he was talking about how that was his philosophy as a player, that he took pride in the fact that he's been in the league however many years he's been in the league, and he's never ordered room service on the road. Mm. He always goes out and finds a couple guys, or maybe more than a couple guys. And so he was kind of appalled when he found out that the Leafs, through all these last handful of playoff runs, had not been going to team dinners on the road in the playoffs. Most of the guys were eating in the hotel, and they were having sort of like, you know, bunker mentality, I guess, was the answer, right? And he was like, no, we're not doing that. So Luke Shen became kind of the social convener.
Well, supposedly Ryan Reeves is gonna
take his place now because Luke's gone. But I found that interesting that, you know, the Leafs had not been doing it. And they were all kind of talking about how, because they did it playing against Tampa, they ate out on the road, nice restaurants, but all together, it was mandatory team function. You know, private rooms, so they're not bothered by
the
riffraff.
Of course.
They really liked it. And guess what? They won the series. Now, I guess they lost the series against Florida. I'm not saying it's because
of the team dinners.
The team dinners that they won.
But it might be.
But I'm not saying it's not. And I do think there's something to that, right? Yeah. Like the idea that you got to connect with guys. Like if you're not connecting off the ice, like there's not a lot of time to connect in the dressing room.
Yeah, like when I was a young guy, you know, I could have been guilty of being the hermit and being too focused on not going out as much. But I happened to live with a good friend of mine still to this day, Matt Kennedy. He was in the Ducks organization with me. And he was kind of the social convener of the team, especially in Syracuse, my first year pro. And that was great for me because that got me out of my shell a little bit because he was always setting up get-togethers with different guys, whether it was at our place, at their place, going out to the local pub, like whatever it was like we were doing this. And it was hilarious because I was taking school courses at the time and I'd convinced him to do the same. And so Tuesdays, because in the American League, you typically play on the weekends. And so Tuesdays was like our day where I was like, all right, Kens, we're going to go to the Syracuse library. We're going to get our work done for the week. He's like, fine, but I'm only going to the library if we get to go for a beer after. And the amount of times that one beer turned into way too many and Wednesday morning practices were certainly interesting.
I love that. Syracuse, also one of the best barbecues in the country.
Incredible. And a great campus, too.
Yeah, great campus. Dinosaur Barbecue.
Dinosaur Barbecue. Yes, I've been there.
We'll get into more stories of your playing days. Your ex-teammate, Byron Frey, is going to join the show. This is Overdrive on TSN.